بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So brothers and sisters, we continue with the chapter here that is before us, الوعظ والاقتصاد فيه, to advise and also be brief when advising. So in the previous chapters, we looked at some of the etiquettes, some of the instructions from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in terms of when we communicate, when we talk, and when we engage in speech, then it should be meaningful, it should be purposeful, and at the very same time, it should be pleasant, and it should be decent. So, as a continuation or extension, Imam Nawawi talks about the fact that many times communication will be to advise another, to give another person some sort of instruction. So even in this situation, one is to be considerate of all those etiquettes, those instructions that we covered in the previous chapters. But at the same time, there's one important point, and that is to be brief, especially when advising. One is to be brief, and one should be considerate of the situation and the condition that is at hand. So many times, a person may be advising, but it goes to so lengthy that a person becomes sort of uninterested, or they lose the vision or the purpose or the objective. So through these narrations, Imam Nawawi is listing that whenever the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, gave advices, it was to the point, it was purposeful, it was meaningful, and it was very comprehensive. So here, Imam Nawawi lists the verse of the Qur'an, أُدْعُوا إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Invite to the path of your Lord with wisdom and a beautiful advice. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is being instructed in this verse that he should call towards the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with two things, with wisdom and also مَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ, meaning beautiful advice. Now the scholars, they get into the details as to what is meant by maw'izat al-hasana. So some say that it refers to maw'iz al-Qur'an, that when advising, the advice should be based on teachings from the Qur'an, from the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. When he takes that advice, it should be taken from the Qur'an. وَقِيلَ الْكَلَامُ اللَّيِّنُ الْخَالِي مِنَ التَّغْلِيذِ وَالتَّعْنِيفِ. And some others say maw'izat al-hasana means to advise in such a way that it's soft words, it's gentle words, and it doesn't turn a person away. It doesn't take a person away further from the purpose of that advice. Now, there are a few narrations in this chapter. The first one is on the strength of Abu Wa'il, Shaqiq ibn Salama radiyallahu anhu. He mentions that Ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, يُذَكِّرُنَا فِي كُلِّ خَمِيسٍ. He would advise us. He would have a weekly discourse, and this would be taking place every Thursday. كُلُّ خَمِيسَةٍ مَرَّةٍ. It was once in a week, every Thursday. فَقَالَ لَهُ رَجُلٌ. A man came to Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu and requested, يَا أَبَا عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ. O Ibn Mas'ud, لَوَدِدْتُ أَنَّكَ ذَكَّرْتَنَا كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. I feel that it would be better if you advise us every single day. Faqal, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu responded by saying, Ama innahu yamna'uni min thalik. The only thing that prevents me from this is that I fear that if I advise you every single day, then it would cause boredom. You would lose interest. Wa inni atakhawwalukum bil maw'idha. And Ibn Mas'ud said, the reason why I leave you with a weekly discourse or a weekly piece of advice is that this was the approach that was adopted by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. يَتَخَوَّلُنَا بِهَا. He would do the similar, meaning that it wouldn't be so frequent. It would be on a gradual basis. And the reason is مَخَافَةَ السَّآمَةِ عَلَيْنَا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would fear that we would lose interest. So we see here also that part of communication, that it should be purposeful, it should be meaningful. When a person is constantly under some specific piece of advice, and it causes boredom, or it causes a person to lose interest, then the objective is lost. So the ulama, they always mention in the terms of fiqh that there is many things that are maqsood bidhat, meaning they are the objective. And then there are others that are wasail ila al-maqsood. They are the means to reach the purpose. A simple example is that when we perform our prayers, the objective is the prayer itself. And one of the means to adhere to this prayer is we have to perform wudu. So wudu is the wasila, it's the means. And the objective, the purpose is the salah. So the ulama say that focus should be on the purpose, not on the wasila. And this is why many ulama, they agree that if a person performs wudu with no intention, they have no intention of being in the state of wudu for reward, or performing a salah, or touching the Qur'an and reciting the Qur'an, then that wudu would be considered a wastage of water. And that would constitute sin. Because a person engaged in the wasila, engaged in the means, and lost the objective or the purpose. So it's the same idea here, that the purpose of the advice, the purpose of the discourse is that people take a message and they change their lives. Now if a person is constantly bombarded with this type of advice and they lose interest or boredom, then this will be a means for losing the objective. The purpose is not simply to gather and hear a discourse. The purpose is to intake something and then change our lives for the better. So Ibn Mas'ud, he was requested to continue his discourse every single day. But he said, no, I'm going to keep it every Thursday. The reason being is that I fear that you'll lose interest. And this is exactly how the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, taught us. When he would engage in discourses, it would be measured, it would be at the right occasions, and we wouldn't lose interest in that advising of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Now the ulama mention a few things under this narration. One is, مِن طَبْعِ النُّفُوسِ الْمَلَلِ, that it's in the nature of the human being to lose interest. They say the average person's attention span is 20 minutes, right? So no point in going on to 3-hour lectures when the average attention span is only 20 minutes, right? So there has to be a purpose, there has to be an objective. It was also mentioned that from this narration we understand حِرْسُ الصَّحَابَةِ عَلَى مُتَابَعَةِ الرَّسُولِ, that we learn from here that the Sahaba, they were very particular when it came to following the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, in word and also in speech and also in action. So Ibn Mas'ud possibly would have accepted the request, but because he wanted to follow the methodology of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he insisted that I'm going to keep it a week because I fear that there will be boredom and people will lose interest. The next narration on the strength of Abu al-Yaqdan, Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu anhuma, he says that I heard the Messenger, peace and blessings upon him, say, and I gave reference to this narration in one of the last sessions, إِنَّ طُولَ صَلَاتِ الرَّجُلِ وَقِصَرِ خُطْبَتِهِ مِئْنَةُ مِنْ فِقْهِهِ, that the lengthening of a person's prayer and the shortening of his sermon is a sign of this person's understanding of deen. Meaning that a person speaks less and does more action. This is a sign of the proper understanding of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I mentioned the narration of Imam al-Bukhari in Adab al-Mufrad, a time will come when people will speak a lot and there will be less action. Right? The Prophet ﷺ said in that narration that the time right now, meaning with the Sahaba, is such that there's more amal, there's more action, and there's less speech. So the Prophet ﷺ told us this many years ago, 1434 years ago, that the sign of a person's proper understanding of deen is that they'll speak less, they'll do more. It's vice versa nowadays. We speak more, we have more material, more resources. You know, on the internet, we have everything in terms of any hadith we want to research, etc. It's right in front of us. But how much of that is really inside ourselves? And practically, are we demonstrating in our lives? So the Prophet ﷺ says, the lengthening of a person's prayer, this is the action, right? To lengthen the prayer. وَقِصَرِ خُطْبَتِهِ, and the sermon being short and brief, to the point. This is a sign min fiqhi, from the understanding, the proper understanding of the deen. فَأَطِيلُ الصَّلَاةَ وَأَقْصِرُ الْخُطْبَةَ. So the Prophet ﷺ said, I advise you that you lengthen the prayer and you shorten the khutbah. So some of the ulama say that this is giving reference to the Friday sermon, that the salah should be more lengthier than the sermon. And other ulama say that this is in general, that a person should speak less and do more. The maqsood, the purpose, as we were talking about earlier, is the action. It's not the speech, right? What do they say? They say the more we talk, the more talk spreads, right? If we engage in action, then action spreads. Umm Salma radiallahu ta'ala anha, she gave the very important advice to the Prophet ﷺ when the Prophet ﷺ felt that the companions are not taking my advice at the occasion of the Hudaybiyah, where the Sahaba, they were so emotionally stressed that they felt that how can we return to Medina without performing Umrah? So Umm Salma radiallahu anha gave the advice to the Prophet ﷺ, the suggestion that just go do the action. Go in their midst and start shaving your hair, taking off your ihram. And when the Sahaba saw the action, they also engaged in that very same action and they joined the Prophet ﷺ in returning to Medina without performing the Umrah. So when we act, then action will spread. When we speak, then words will spread. So again, the idea here, Imam Nawawi is listing these narrations to show that the purpose is the action. And if advice needs to be given, it should be purposeful, to the point, brief and meaningful. The next narration, on the strength of Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam al-Sulami, radiyallahu ta'ala an, he mentions that, بَيْنَا أَنَا أُصَلِّي مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I was once praying with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِذْ عَطَسَ رَجُلٌ مِّنَ الْقَوْمِ. And someone sneezed in the midst of the prayer. فَقُلْتُ. And after I heard this person sneezing, I said, يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ. May Allah show mercy upon you. And this is the etiquette, this is the sunnah, that when someone sneezes, and we're supposed to respond. Now there's a difference of opinion as to why this person responded. Some say that he had recently accepted Islam, and he didn't know the etiquettes, he didn't know the rules and the protocol of prayer. And others say that this person was not present when the revelation came down to prohibit speech in prayer. وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ. This is the verse that came down, which emphasized to the Prophet ﷺ and the believers that speech, communication, is no longer permitted in prayer. So whatever the case may be, someone sneezed, and Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam al-Sulami responded to that sneeze by saying, may Allah have mercy on you. فَرَمَانِ الْقَوْمِ بِأَبْصَارِهِمْ. He mentions that the people started looking at me in a negative way. They're showing me their gazes. فَقُلْتُ. So I said, I started speaking in salah, وَاثَكَلَا أُمَّيَاهُ. Have I done something wrong? Have I done something inappropriate? مَا شَأْنُكُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ إِلَيْهِ. Why are you all staring at me? So he's speaking in salah. فَجَعَلُوا يَضْرِبُونَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ عَلَىٰ أَفْغَاذِهِمْ. So they began tapping their hands on their thighs in the prayer to indicate that the speech is no longer permissible. فَلَمَّا رَأَيْتُهُمْ يُصَمِّتُونِ. So when I understood from their gestures that I'm supposed to be quiet, سَكَتُّ. I remained silent. فَلَمَّا صَلَّى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. The Prophet ﷺ completed the prayer and he brought me close. فَأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي مَا رَأَيْتُ مُعَلِّمًا قَبْلَهُ وَلَا بَعْدَهُ أَحْسَنَ تَعْلِيمًا مِنْهُ. He says that I sacrifice my parents for this great man, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I've never seen a teacher before him, and I don't think so I'll ever see a teacher as good as him after him. أَحْسَنَ تَعْلِيمًا. Such beautiful teachings and approach in giving the advice and the admonition. فَوَاللَّهِ مَا كَهَرَنِي. I swear by Allah, مَا كَهَرَنِي. The Prophet ﷺ didn't force me. وَلَا ضَرَبَنِي. He didn't beat me. وَلَا شَتَمَنِي. And he didn't abuse me. He was giving the advice, but he was very gentle about it. I did a big mistake. I caused disturbance in the salah, and people were upset about it. But the Prophet ﷺ, he gave me the advice, he admonished me, but it was so comprehensive, it was to the point, it was meaningful, and it was gentle, that I understood the message, and the objective was attained. So he says, I've never seen a teacher like the Prophet ﷺ that he didn't force me, he didn't beat me, he didn't abuse me in his words or language or his physical gestures. And then he said, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الصَّلَاةِ This prayer, لَا يَصْلُحُ فِيهَا شَيْءٍ Nothing is permitted مِنْ كَلَامِ النَّاسِ From the general speech of humans. Okay, the speech that we engage in when we are in salah is communication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, it is not permitted to engage in speech as we do amongst people. إِنَّمَا هِيَ التَّسْبِيحُ وَالتَّكْبِيرُ It's simply to glorify Allah and to exalt Allah. وَقِرَاءَةُ الْقُرْآنِ And we recite the Qur'an in salah. أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ And he mentions, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave me a similar type of advice. قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ So I asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is the reason why many of the scholars say that he had just accepted Islam, he was not aware of the protocol. He said, O Messenger of Allah, إِنِّي حَدِيثُ عَهْدٍ بِجَاهِلِيَّةِ I was just in the ignorance. I just accepted Islam, I was just in ignorance. وَقَدْ جَاءَ اللَّهُ بِهَا الْإِسْلَامِ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought Islam to me. وَإِنَّ مِنَّا رِجَالًا يَأْتُونَ الْكُهَّانِ I have a question, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are many people amongst us who used to go to the fortune tellers. So what is your suggestion? What is your advice? So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, فَلَا تَأْتِهِمْ Don't go to them. قُلْتُ وَمِنَّا رِجَالٌ يَتَطَيَّرُونَ So then I asked, there are some people amongst us that are accustomed to believing in omens. Believing in omens. قَالَ ذَاكَ شَيْءٌ يَجِدُونَهُ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ So the Prophet ﷺ responded by saying, these are certain matters that people bring into their minds, into their hearts. فَلَا يَسُدَّنَّهُمْ This should not deter a person from doing what they need to. And then this is where the narration ends. So basically the gist of this narration is that the Prophet ﷺ gave the admonition, he gave the advice, it was very purposeful, meaningful, gentle, and the objective was attained. Another thing that is being mentioned here is the Prophet ﷺ was asked a few questions, and we see here two matters. Number one is fortune telling. We don't believe in fortune telling. The reason being is that Allah only knows the future. Right? There's no one in the creation that knows the future. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the messengers, whenever they talk about the future, it was revelation that was revealed to them through which they're able to tell us. For example, the Prophet ﷺ talks about the coming of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam before the day of judgment. So how did the Prophet ﷺ come to realize this? It was revelation that was revealed to him. By his nature, he couldn't tell the future. By his nature, he couldn't tell the future. And there are many evidences about this. For example, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, sent a group of 70 companions for da'wah. And these companions, they were martyred. Had the Prophet ﷺ known that these people had an evil intention, they had requested the Prophet ﷺ, we want the best amongst your people to teach us Qur'an, to teach us the deen. So the Prophet ﷺ selected the Sahaba who were the most articulate, the most well-trained, but they had passed away when these people were ambushed and there was a plot that was made against them. So the ulama writes, they write that had the Prophet ﷺ had the knowledge of the unseen, then he would not have sent these companions. Right? So even the prophets, they don't have the inherent quality to tell the future. So our belief is, it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has the knowledge of the future. And the other thing is that the Prophet ﷺ told this companion that we don't believe in omens. So some people believe that, you know, it's Muharram, so we shouldn't get married. Or, you know, it's Safar. Safar means the month that just passed. Safar comes from Sifar, which means zero, nil. So we shouldn't engage in important activities in the month of Safar. So these are all customs. Okay, these are all customs and they're superstitions. We don't believe in these type of superstitions. Now, the Prophet ﷺ in one narration, he was asked about a positive omen. So the Prophet ﷺ said, if you want to take a positive omen, that is permissible. But again, it should not be the motivating factor to do something or to stay away from something. Right? Because our belief is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was very common during the time of Jahiliyyah. They would have arrows and they would throw them. And if they would fall in the right direction, this means that there was something positive. And if the arrow fell in the left direction, then this would mean negative. So they would put their beliefs into this. Right? They would put their beliefs into this. So the other day I was talking to a non-Muslim, and he was saying, you know, I don't make major decisions on Wednesdays. So he says, in our culture, Wednesdays is a bad luck day. Right? So this is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ is referring to here, that لَا يَسُدَّنَّهُمْ, we should not be deterred from doing what we have to do because of these superstitions. يَتَطَيَّرُونَ, because of this, what we're doing is we're linking our beliefs with something other than the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet ﷺ's advice was brief, it was meaningful, and it was to the purpose here. And one last narration in this chapter on the strength of Irbad ibn Sariyah radiyallahu ta'ala an. He mentions that at one occasion, wa'adhana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet ﷺ delivered a sermon, he delivered a discourse, maw'idha, and it was a powerful discourse. Wajilat minha al-qulub, our hearts began trembling. Wadharafat minha al-uyun, and our eyes began to shed tears. Wadhakara al-hadith, and the companion listed some of the advices that were mentioned in this hadith. And Imam Nawawi says here, سَبَقَ بِكَلَامِهِ فِي بَابِ الْأَمْرِ بِالْمُحَافَظَةِ عَلَى السُّنَّةِ. He said, I've already given reference to this hadith in its complete form in one of the previous chapters, but he says, the purpose that I'm bringing this hadith here is about the fact that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, gave a meaningful, purposeful advice. It was brief, it was to the point, and it really made a difference in the lives of the companions. They say, وَجِلَتْ مِنْهَا الْقُلُوبِ, our hearts trembled through that piece of advice. And we began to shed tears, meaning it had an effect, it had an impact on them. It wasn't simply empty words. It was words with that emotion, with that intention, and with the proper connection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the explanation of this narration, it's pointed out here, أَحْسَنَ الْمَوَائِذِ مَا كَانَ جَزْلًا جَامِعًا بَلِيغًا نَافِعًا, that the best of advices are those, we learned this from this narration, the scholar says, أَحْسَنُ الْمَوَائِذِ, the best of advices is that, جَزْلًا جَامِعًا, that it's brief, but it's comprehensive. بَلِيغًا نَافِعًا, it reaches the hearts of the people, and it brings benefit. It reaches the hearts of people, and it brings benefit. There's one narration that is connected to this, so we'll just read this narration and conclude here. الْوَقَارُ وَالسَّكِينَةِ, Imam Nawawi says, part of communication is also that a person needs to be serious at the right time, and when it's time to joke or jest, then that's fine. But the ultimate purpose should be that a person is serious and knows their purpose and their objective. The Prophet ﷺ also engaged in jest, and he also joked around, he smiled, etc. But from his joking, it wasn't understood that this person is in ghafla. This person is in total unawareness of what's happening. Many times a person engages in so much entertainment that they have no objective, they have no purpose. That becomes the purpose of their life, right? So, in this narration, what Imam Nawawi is bringing forth is that we need to understand from this narration that the Prophet ﷺ was serious about his purpose, about his objective. Here and there he had pleasant moments, he joked, he smiled, etc. But his purpose was never forgotten. Al-waqaru was-sakina, to be a dignified person and to have tranquility, to be dignified and have tranquility. So he lists the verse, عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. The servants of the Most Merciful are those, يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ, that they walk on this earth, هَوْنَا, in a gentle way. إِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ, and when the ignorant engage in discussions with them, they are peaceful with them. They say peace. Now what's the narration? Aisha radiallahu anha mentions that مَا رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, I've never seen the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam مُسْتَجْمِعًا قَطُّ ضَاحِكًا, I've never seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laugh so intensely that his uvula would come into appearance. Meaning that when a person really opens their mouth and they laugh, then we can see the inside of their mouth. Right, a person does what the ulama say. There's three types of laughter or smiling. One is what we call qahqaha, and this is what is being referred to here. Qahqaha, that a person laughs so loud. Number one is there is voice, there's sound with it. And number two is their teeth and their internal mouth becomes apparent. And in some case, a person falls onto the ground or is unable to control themselves. So this is what Aisha is saying, radiallahu anha, that the Prophet ﷺ never laughed like this in his life. He never opened his mouth to the extent where his teeth would be exposed and the inside of his mouth. Uvula is that small piece of flesh that hangs near the throat, right? That was never ever exposed when the Prophet ﷺ laughed. The other method of laughing is what we call dihk. So the teeth are exposed, If there is sound, it's very little, it's not so intense. And then what is what we call tabassum, which is simply a smile. And in the case of a smile, rarely any teeth are exposed, and there is no sound. So what does Aisha radiallahu anha say? That the Prophet ﷺ was a dignified person, he always remained focused in terms of his purpose, and that's why I've never seen the Prophet ﷺ laugh so intensely where his uvula became apparent. إِنَّمَا كَانَ يَتَبَسَّمْ. The Prophet ﷺ, whenever he was happy or he was in a situation of being joyful, then it would be a smile or a laugh. It would be a smile or a laugh. It wouldn't be a qahqah. It wouldn't be a loud laughter. So again, what do we understand from here is that a person should never lose sight of the objective and the purpose. So we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with these etiquettes and these morals. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to follow the beautiful teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the success of this life and also in the hereafter. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى من القول والعمل والنية والهدي والهدى